All right. Again, welcome to all. This is our first week in the new book after 26 weeks of dealing with Luke. In the New Testament, we're going to go back to one of the oldest books in the Bible, all the way back to the patriarchic time of Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, all the way back to them. And theologians, which I'm not, argue back and forth, how is it before, after, or during the time of Abraham. But, and it's positioned, Job, the book of Job is positioned in the Psalms versions. And it seems like if you talk about Bible in context, to me, it seems like the positioning of it being in Psalms seemed like if it's so old, it would have been back in history and law. But they know what they were doing because it's a song of, it's a book of wisdom. And it falls into the proper spot right there. I think in the Israelites' wisdom literature, we went over this a little earlier, fell into two categories. Wisdom for, in Proverbs, was the wisdom for the skills of life. And in Job and Ecclesiastes, it was the wisdom for human existence and dealing with the problems of human existence. And that was a little bit.
Charles Jones.
Welcome, sir. And before we get started in it, let's just go back with a little bit in verses, Job 1 verses 1 up through 8. I'm not going to read them all, but we all went over it. It was like they talk about where he was from, Uz, and then it talks about his character. That man was perfect and upright and one that feared God. So they're showing right there that he has wisdom because he's fearing God and he was against evil. And then he was blessed because his life was fulfilled with 7 sons and 3 daughters, 10 children. And then he had plenty, plenty wealth. I mean, you know, at this time, I guess him and Abraham around these times, these were projected as some of the richest guys there were at that time. So anyway, if we're not speaking right now, let's remember to turn our microphones off. And so also being, you know, he talks about how Job was also concerned and cared for his family because he went up at a certain time and he made an offering for his children. And so this is showing that his priestly aspect of Job, he was the priest of his family. In those days, we didn't have direct access through Christ Jesus, but they had a priest that had to give you access to God. So he was doing his priestly duty for his children. And so he was upright, he was a good man, he was a priest. And then also, there was also, if we look in the Old Testament, there was always a time that we have to give God, like Cain and Abel had to make their offering at the appropriate time. And so we're going to look in this book today, in mainly in the book where it says, the day came in verse 6, when the sons of men, sons of God, came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Now I want to stop right there to deal with little bit about the sons of God. I battled with this for a long time because a lot of times I always believe, since we're in New Testament, I always believe that sons of God were people that followed Jesus, okay, or believers. But Old Testament breaks it down beautifully in that sons of God were also fallen, well, angels and also good angels. Also,
good morning, everyone. This is Sister Allen. I just simply wanted to say I believe, yes, because we know that God, well, God created us. He knew us when we were knitted in our mother's womb. The thing is, as we come to know God, everything, he must test his children. And so the key at the time we incur adversity, the question is, do I have enough of God inside of me? And so the painful thing is when everything is going okay, you believe that, yes, I'm a Christian, this is what I will do when an adverse situation occur, but you yourself don't know what's inside of you. So the Lord has to sift us, allow us to be sifted, to find, so that you can find out and come to know what's really inside of you and whether or not you really do have enough of God inside of you.
Very good. Now, all three good points. First one is Job was not present at the time, which is when this conversation between God and Satan took place. The most important thing about Job not being present, this is a thing that breaks down to what is faith, okay? You know, and then, you know, because he didn't know this, so this was going to be a testing of his faith. And then also Job is a book, the total book of Job is declaring the sovereignty of God. You know, he can do what he pleases with his creation because he's sovereign. And then I think a scripture that helps me support that is Psalms 115:3 says, but our God is in heaven and he has done whatsoever he has pleased. So that psalm right there showing the sovereignty of God right there, that he can do whatever he pleased. You know, when in one book of the Bible, they talk about he creates the lump of clay, one for honor and one for dishonor, you know, but he creates it all. So the sovereignty of God is the main thing, and the faith of Job is the main thing of this whole book that we're going to continue to go through. And so anyone else back on the question of, you know, remembering when calamity or things happen to you, remembering who's in control?
It causes us to have the right reaction rather than the wrong reaction. When we know God is ultimately in control, then we don't feel like we have to take control and do the wrong thing. We know that he's superintending over it all, no matter what. I don't worry about who's in the White House because I know God's ultimately in control and nothing's going to happen that he doesn't give permission to happen and doesn't have a purpose for happening. So I'm not as likely to think I have to do something, I have to do whatever it takes, because God's in control, and I can stay faithful, and I can stay in my character as a Christian. I don't have to step outside of that mold because God's got it, and I don't have to worry about it. And that was the point to make to Job. No matter what, he's going to be faithful to me and not give up, not sin, just because I take something away from him, because he knows I'm in control and he's going to have what he needs. So it keeps you from being swayed by the circumstance.
Amen.
Amen. And see, again, like the sister was saying earlier about what's inside, and then that's really the faith that's inside of you. You know, it's that spiritual trust that's inside of you in God. Say in practical terms, you know, that's it right there. Inside of you, you got to have that faith in your heart, Christ in your heart, you know, to help you navigate through these times of challenges, because No matter what, you always look at the time of blessing. Satan, look at Jesus' example. When did Satan attack Jesus? Right after he was baptized. He went off into the wilderness. He immediately, when we're at that high, that good peak, Satan say, okay, we got to distract him. Even back there, looking back in Genesis, we're talking about the sons of God. They're in heaven. They're in paradise. But then the angels come down to pervert everything. Satan and his demons, when they fell down, he brought his crew down, and they just start trying to mess up everything. Have to destroy it all. But anyway, anyone else before we go to the second portion of this lesson?
We have to stand on God's promises when we're going through afflictions and calamities and stuff. If we remember God's word and what he has promised, and we should rely on what he's told us. And Psalms 91, for example, you know, he says that he's our refuge, our fortress, and we must trust in him. We have to dwell in the secret place of the Most High, in the shadow of his wings. We also, he tells us in his word that you don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, and rulers, you know, darkness. And so all of these promises, when I'm going through things, I just go straight to the word and start, you know, dwelling on God's great promises that he has for us, and that gives me strength.
And that thought goes to hand.
You know, before we got started, we were talking and about how a lot of preachers don't preach on the book of Job. And I think we were saying that if they really studied into Job, he really destroys the prosperity gospel that people are preaching these days, you know, and how he does it. Because, look, his description in the beginning of the book, Job was prosperous. Job was well-do, you know, and, you know, he was looked at by men as well as God, you know, with admiration. And he just destroyed the prosperity gospel with this. I don't know if that's why a lot of preachers don't preach on it, but his going through all this stuff and his faith in God, the sovereign God, and his understanding that God was sovereign is what really Job, how Job totally destroys all that prosperity gospel. So now we're going to go over to the attack executed, verses 13 through 19.
All right. One day when Job's sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and reported, "While the oxen were plowing and the donkeys grazing nearby, the Sabines swooped down and took them away. They struck down the servants with the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you." He was still speaking when another messenger came and reported, "God's fire fell from heaven. It burned the sheep and the servants and devoured them, and I alone have escaped to tell you." The messenger was still speaking when another came and reported, "The Chaldeans have formed three bands and made a raid on the camels and took them away. They struck down the servants with the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you." He was still speaking when another messenger came and reported, "Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. Suddenly a powerful wind swept in from the desert and struck the four corners of the house. It collapsed on the young people so that they died, and I alone have escaped to tell you."
Lord, add a blessing to the reading and the hearing His word. So, again, here it is. We look at God granted permission, and Satan went right to work. First, he used the wicked men, and they talk about the men, they call them out as Sabaeans. And, you know, we could talk about a little bit history of the Sabaeans here, but they were supposedly descendants or prior to the Queen of Sheba that dealt with David a little bit later on. But, like, he used these wicked people, and he destroyed Job's wealth and a bunch of his workers in this first calamity. And then you look at the next section, he uses Satan here, is using supernatural events like fire from heaven. You know, this is attacking him, Job, in the spiritual realm. And then at the same time, he is destroying his sheep and his burn and devour them, right? And his camels, you know, that's his transportation. They got, they came there and they destroyed all of them. Now, this, you're looking at all this now, and just think about, this is a mass destruction. Because if you have, say, 500 yoke of oxen, I'm thinking a yoke is like two oxen. So somebody got to drive it. So even at 500, that's got to be at least 250 people. And I'm thinking that, I don't know, I'm not on a farm, but a yoke, and I don't know nobody who did it, but it's just in my mind that I'm going to add another person in there, because when you're in back of those oxen, somebody has to be steering them to keep them on a straight path. So you have to have a guide to point him down the line. So now that same thing then went from 250 to almost 500 people that are being destroyed just with this portion right here alone. So this was a massive thing. He had great, great wealth and a lot of servants. And then also the last portion in 19 and 18, when the winds east, west, because it hit the four corners, it came from all directions. And we're not talking about a nice little thunderstorm or rain coming down. We're talking about something like a tsunami or a hurricane or a typhoon. But this was a supernatural event as well that Satan had used. So we're looking at all, he's being attacked by his human aspects, and he's thinking he's being attacked from heaven as well. So his permission was granted, and the tax was executed. And here's Job in this situation right here. So the question, and then and that little information that I said about the Sabaeans, you can see that on page 15 in our Sunday school book. That clarifies that. And then, so the question on page 16 is, what can believers learn about the timing, suddenness, and severity of Satan's attack from these verses?
Hmm. Well, Job didn't have time to recover between attacks, that's for sure.
Yeah.
One right after the other. And they were all severe. They weren't just like, oh, I cut my finger or something like that. You know, this is this.
I think he started with his material wealth.
Mm-hmm.
And then he ran on down through, and the closest he got to him was his family.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which was the last one that that Satan hit.
Oh, and then you forgot to mention also, the boils on his body, right?
That's coming in a minute.
Yeah.
Yeah. We ain't got here yet, huh?
Right. Well, we ain't got there yet. Because we told him don't touch him yet.
Right.
So okay, I'm sorry. I'm getting a little ahead. Go ahead, brother.
I'm finished.
Who else?
So why did he have these boys? Because he was told not to touch him.
Speak up, Sister Diane. He was told not to touch him. That's the only part I got.
Why did he have all these boys and Satan was told not to touch Job's body?
No, we're not on this part yet. We're not there yet.
We're not there yet.
Yeah, not yet.
No. He told, Miss Clayton is saying that back in the earlier part that God told Satan he can't touch Job. That's the point that she was bringing back with the winds, the tsunamis, all his wealth taken away. He still couldn't lay his hand on him. I think that's what she was saying.
That comes later.
Yeah.
Okay, what he said, what question was, what can believers learn about the sudden?
That was on page, we on page, the question on page 17, right?
Oh, 17 or 16.
No, yeah, it's on, no, wait a minute, I might have jumped to the wrong question.
Oh, 16.
Yeah, I jumped to the wrong. Yeah, that came 16. Later. No wonder I jumped to the wrong question. I want to be on the question on page 16, which is, what can believers learn about the timing, suddenness, and severity of Satan's attack from these verses? Yeah, that's what I read before.
Yeah.
We can see in 1 Peter that the Satan's about the earth he may destroy. And, of course, he can't do anything without God's permission. And that his attacks of they're wicked, they're evil. We see that today. It wasn't just in Job, but we see all that's happening today and how he's done and what he's done to throughout the different countries and to people. He's vicious. And we don't know when he's going to attack. That's why I said in Paul that we should pray all time, be watchful and pray to be protected from others.
That's right. Go ahead.
I think also Job's response to all of this, well, Job should have been truly devastated with this happening suddenly like this at once, but Job wasn't a fleshly person. He was operating with God's word, and the statement that he made, that he came here with nothing and he's leaving with nothing.
But you're jumping ahead of us. We're not there yet.
I'm jumping ahead.
Yeah, we're not there yet.
But the key is what we have on the inside of us. That's what's going to sustain us. And that's what sustains us.
That's correct. But see, right now, as we're looking at these attacks, our main thing about the attacks was the timing, the suddenness, and the severity of the attacks in these verses. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is basically trying to get us to punch in the fact in there that Satan, that sister said when Peter, that he roaming the earth, seeking you and me. Mm-hmm. Even, like you're saying, it's inside of us. It's in there, that faith, all that stuff is in us. But Satan is, do you know, you don't know like the hour or the thief when he's going to come. You don't know Satan, you know, Jesus told Peter that he wants to sift him like wheat, you know. And then you don't know, as she said, he's walking around the earth seeking prey to devour, to kill, and destroy. His total mission. That's Satan's mission statement right there. To seek, prey, to devour, to kill, and destroy, and to lie to you. That's his whole, that's his mission statement. And so that's why attack executed, and these are, he used, they're just trying to show you that Satan can use nature, he can use man, he can use anything to knock the believer. And then, like I use that thing, like the example, when we're at our highest peak, when we really exercise in our good faith and all that good Christianity inside us,
right.
Oh, my. What did they say about pride? Comes before the fall. Pride
right.
comes before the fall. So the attack executed on, it's not saying that Job was bragging about his pride or what he had or anything. Now we're going to get into the section of where, because we're running out of time, but we're going to get into the section where it says that trust in God is maintained.
Brother
Go
Joe.
Ahead.
Hey, Brother Joe, I think it's important for us to understand that we have to have our guards up at all times. Now, you were asking here the timing and the subtleness. Sometimes attacks come boldly, and sometimes they come subvertly, where we don't even understand it or don't even feel it when it hits. But I've heard many people say you're either in a storm, coming out of one, or getting ready to go into one. But we know that God controls the storm. So, but clearly in this case with Job, he was, as you said, on top of everything. He had everything going well for him, and that's when Satan attacked. But certainly you could be going through stuff, and here comes another attack. Because here he gets hit with so many attacks at the same time. I mean, one of those would have been enough, you know, but they just kept coming and coming and coming. So I think the message is to have our guards up at all times and to not put our guards down. And again, we have to put our trust in God, knowing that it's all going to be working for good.
And we also
all right.
have to make sure we get up, we get dressed in the armor of God, because you don't know when Satan is going to attack, so you have to put on the full armor of God, because Satan always operates in antithesis of those of the fruit of the Spirit. That's why it came like it did, because nothing about him resonates fruit of the Spirit. He's evil. So we have to discipline ourselves just like Daniel, pray morning, noon, and night.
Amen.
Yeah,
amen.
So true. The one thing I think we do, sometimes we minimize Satan. We act like he don't exist or that's trivial. And I think this tells you he is there, he is real, he is powerful, and we have to be on the watch for him.
Amen, brother. Go ahead, brother.
I think also what we can learn is that the timing, the coordinate, we can't control that. There's nothing we can do. All we have to do, I mean, it's been said many times, is to trust God, that God is in control. So that is what I think about what has just happened. That we will still know that all these calamities of evil challenges are happening, but God is in control. I think that's what I learned. You know, from Job. Job is not privy to that conversation. We are. But at the same time, it teaches us that no matter what is going on, believers can learn that God is in control no matter what is going on.
Amen. And he doesn't fight fair. He doesn't fight fair. This is guerrilla warfare. This is camouflage. He can come from, you know, any angle. You know, this is not the red coats versus the blue coats. We just stand there having a fight. No. And of course, you know, some of the worst attacks can come from people who you love the most. So it's not a fair fight at all.
Yeah.
Well, as they used to say, the no holds barred. You know, and then, you know, when you're in war, you know, like, you know, you don't draw no time out. You can take a time out. It don't work like that. You can't be taking no time outs. You know, spiritual warfare. You don't be taking no time. Like she say, put that armor on when you wake up. Like, be ready, because you don't never know when the attack is going to come. And then, you already down. They say, do you kick a dog when he down? Satan will. You know, you can be down, he going to kick you. Yep. So anyway, he wants to do anything he can to keep Jesus from coming here and making that connection for between man and God, you know. And again, we mentioned it earlier that that was one of the reasons why the flood had to come, because of all these evil sons of God that were down here on the earth mingling. But anyway, let's go to the last section if there's nobody else that want to speak on this question right here. And that one would be trust maintained, 20 through 22. We're closing it out now, bringing him on home.
Then Job stood up and tore his robe and shaved his head. He fell to the ground and worshipped, saying, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will leave this life. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Throughout all this, Job did not sin or blame God for anything.
Lord, add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Trust maintained. This is what our memory verse right here was, that Job and we, if we're doing our work and we're being armored, we know what to do in these situations. And Job demonstrated it right off the bat. He worshiped the Lord. And then, watch, Job, after he went through the proper posture of shaving his head by the people back then, that was a way to get ready to show grief and everything. But look at Job's prayer. It's short. It's not no, oh, Lord, in this calamity, oh, I will. No. Look what he says. He says, first of all, it was a three-aspect prayer. And then in three amazing affirmations that Job makes. The first, all life comes from God. God is life. And he stood up, shaved his head, and he first off said, naked I came, and naked I will return. And then that was his life. Job understood. He saw God, that he provided everything. Second, he noticed the sovereign rule of God. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away, you know. And then the third part of this prayer was that the prosperity and the adversary, adversity, that the Lord is worthy. So what it's, I'm trying to say is, through our prosperity and through our adverse situations, Job, in this situation, what? Didn't blame God, and he blessed the name of the Lord. He gives, he takes away, you know, he came naked, you know, but Job still knew the most important thing is, blessed be the name of the Lord. Just like he told his wife, are you crazy? Do we only thank God for good? That's a little bit later on. But anyway, and so then it closed out in, Job did not sin nor blame God. Isn't that a, look, isn't that a quick, short prayer? And it right. covered everything. And he didn't pull an Adam and Eve, that woman you gave me, or any of those things. He didn't point no fingers. He didn't blame God or anything.
Right.
And then, you know, and then he didn't say nobody beguiled him, nothing. He just went on and said, at the end, he said, through all this, did not sin or blame God for anything. So our question on this is, how does viewing God as sovereign over all his creation impact how people respond to loss in life? And I think I boiled it all down. My saying was Job 1:21. The Lord gives, the Lord takes. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
That destroys that prosperity stuff.
Yeah. Because I think, too, we need to look at the behavior of Job and the conduct right here. Job didn't take 2 days to speak. It's immediately he made these statements, which let you know from the heart, the mouth speaks, which was in the last book that we had, Luke 6:45. From the heart, the mouth speaks. So that means that this faithfulness was already in his heart. He didn't have to go somewhere and conjure this up and think about it. And this was already in his heart. As Ms. Grimes say, we need to stay ready. As you always say, Joe, we need to stay ready so we don't have to get ready, right?
Amen.
Joe was ready. He was ready for this.
I think also that Job just put Satan to shame, you know. He just shamed Satan because that was the accusation. He said that Job worship God for nothing. So he just by putting Satan's question, you know, present themselves before God. And that was what God was bragging Job. He said, hey, my boss. You know, so right now, Job understood that, yes, that God is still in control and God is sovereign, like you said. So the question first, worshiping God worthy of worship. Job showed that. And Job now is sovereignty of God. So both the question answered, and Job demonstrated it, that everything that or will ever have belong.
Amen.
Yeah. Putting right to shame.
Now, I think looking back on Luke, Job has given us the example that reflects back to our Luke study when we talked about the two brothers. One was a tax collector and one was a publican. And they both, he asked, which one left justified? One who humbled himself before God. And so the point is, right in verse 20, you said immediately, Job stood up, tore his robe, shaved his head. They're preparing yourself to get in the presence of God is very important. See, and that's why that's in there, because you just can't go. I use the example of Elijah. When they approached Elijah to say, hey, the king said, tell Elijah to come back. And the man just ran up in Elijah and said, the king came back. He killed 500. The next group he sent, he killed all them because they approached improperly. When we approach God in calamity, in good times, regardless of the situation, we have to realize that he is God, he is sovereign, he did not have to bless us, he could strike us down, and don't think that since I'm teaching Sunday school or driving the bus or doing something, I'm such a good old Christian and I can just come in with like, okay, God, I'm really busy doing my work here today, just bless me. Nope, you have to humble yourself. You're still a sinner. You're still a sinner under grace daily. You have to have that armor on, and you have to realize you have to be a little selfless and know that everything is from God, and the way you approach him is very, very important to what you're going to get from God. So I think I just wanted to point that right there, how the approach of everything. And then his approach, he got himself in position. Then he just went straight to the point. He didn't dance around. He just went, you know, straight to the point.
Yeah, I think this is kind of summarizing, I guess, what you're saying is that we're going to have adversity. And sometimes we have lots of horrible things happening in our lives, and we get down on our knees and we pray, why me, God? What did I do? Why me? What can I do? And this is really saying, don't question. God is sovereign. Good and bad things are going to happen. Don't question. But lots of times we do. Why did my child die? Why is this happening? Why is the world the way it is? We question, but we shouldn't.
I did this to prove a point. He did this to prove a point to Satan.
He proved God did all this. Let him go through this to prove a point to Satan that and to prove a point to us as believers. Like James said, you know, faith that ain't kept, you know, you got to go through these trials so that you can come through with the crown.
Amen.
You know, you got to be purified, you know.
Yeah.
So I think, too, Joe, we need to, as believers, we need to make sure that we hold to everything on this earth very loosely, because our first love should be God.
Amen.
We need to hold to wife, children, all material things. We need to hold to that stuff very, very loosely. If you lose it, so what? And if you never attain it, so what? This is not your home if you are a believer. Nothing is going with you anyway when you leave here. And I'm sure that was one of Job's thoughts. God's in control.
Very good. Very good. I think that was part of one of the things that I wanted to point out, that in our life, God gives us stuff. We don't own it. We're just here to manage it. You know, he put us as stewards to manage these things. So he gave Job all this wealth, all this prosperity, but he understood that I'm just the manager. All this comes from God, and all of it's going to go back to God when I'm gone, because naked I came and naked I will return. So you're supposed to be a good manager while you're here. And the question is that we've answered so far was, Satan seeks opportunity to attack God's faithful followers. And then the other one was, believers are not immune from experiencing calamity and loss. And believers can worship God even in the midst of life challenges, knowing that God is sovereign.
And we have to enter them.
And so that's the thing, that God is sovereign. That's what that's the whole book of Job. God is sovereign. He can do with his creation, and we just have to be prepared. Because it's going to, like Charles said, you're either in one, going to go through one. It was three of them, he said. Or one's coming.
Yeah, and now I have to disagree, though, with the brother before that said we can't question. This is just personally me, and I may be wrong in saying this, but I believe God wants us to be honest with him. And when I say honest, I mean, I think it's okay for us to question why, God. Why did this happen? Now, he may not ever tell us why. and it's certainly he's God. He doesn't have to answer anything, though. But he wants to hear from us. He wants us to be able to say, hey, what's going on? I mean, David asked, you know, why does the evil man do so well when the good man seems to fall into the ditch all the time? You know, why did this happen to this person and that? So I think he wants us to be honest with him if we're in, because quite frankly, sometimes God doesn't make sense to us in our human mind. We don't get to see the big picture. So I think it's okay to ask God questions. Now, like I said, he may not answer you at that time, or he may give you an answer by and by. But overall, I think he wants us to be honest with him, whatever we're going through.
What I was saying,
it's when you question, it's like you expect to get an answer back from him. He's sovereign, which means, as we were saying, that he does what he does, and we can't always expect for him to answer it, to explain what he's doing. And when we get down like that and we question God, why this, why that, sometimes we really expect to get an explanation from him, and sometimes we're not going to get it.
That, now, I agree with that. Absolutely. Nor does he have to answer it. Absolutely.
When I pray, I'll be like, Lord, I know that you chose creation, but why did you create bugs again? I'm trying to understand.
Yeah.
To bite Charlene.
Lord, help me lick these bugs because they're not going to go anywhere.
I know when I hit one of them. And Lord, I know that you created these bugs for a reason, but they don't belong around me.
Okay. Yeah. They don't belong in my house. Sorry.
Or those cicadas, here come another car wash.
They are all over the place.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Today. Came out over here all the time today. They're all over the place.
Right. All right. Very good.
Hey, brother Joe.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sometimes I think when something goes adverse in my life or around me, I think about, before I question God, I try to figure out, what did I do? What did I do that this is happening to me before I question him? You know? I go back and think, what did I do to make God let this happen to me? I believe in you. I trust you. I know you know everything. But you let this happen to me. So what did I do?
That's a good question. But myself, when I get into situations when I don't feel I'm rightfully being punished, the first thing, one of the things I have done, I ain't gonna say I do it all the time, but one of the things I have done is say it to myself, hey, remember the time you stole that candy? Remember the time you ran that red light? You remember the time you remember the time you cut and talked about somebody behind their back and you never got caught? And then you walk down the street, your old business and get
that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Guys,
it mounts up.
No. I'm saying
the sovereignty of God at the time that I did those things, if God was just like you, like he said at the beginning, that the Satan tells you at the beginning, when you sin, you're going to die. It's not an immediate death. When you do stuff wrong, that separates you as an immediate separation, but the consequences are not always right then and there. But the death didn't fall. The death failed. The connection failed, but the physical death didn't come yet. And so the thing that I'm trying to say is, like, all the bad stuff that I got away with, why should I not be why should I be upset when something happens to me?
Oh. I got you.
When
everything is going good now, huh? I got you.
And then something happens to you.
I got you.
Are you going to get mad? Are you going to get mad now?
Yeah, I got you.
But guys, we also we have got to hold on to this, and we've got to remember this. When we confess our sins, God is faithful and just. He is not
God that continues
to throw it in our face. So when something happens, sometimes the first inclination is, did I ask forgiveness for that, or did I? It's like the story we're learning now about Job. God has a reason for everything, and we don't know what it is. And so sometimes we fall back into that, well, I'm being punished. But God is not that type of God. It says God is a God of love, a God of forgiveness. He doesn't continue. He says once you've asked forgiveness, it's thrown in the sea of forgetfulness. Our God is a God of teaching, a God of learning, trying to get us to focus on Him. And if we hold on, well, I'm being punished for something I did at 2 years old. Once we confess the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, He has forgiven us. And moving forward, even this day, this moment, we can say, Father, forgive us for being impatient. Forgive us for wasting time or whatever it is. And it's forgotten. It's the enemy that allows that stuff to throw back of us, and we hold on into it and say, oh, that's why we're being punished. God doesn't see it as being punished. He has a teaching method for everything, everything, everything. And we have to hold on to that, because if we don't hold on to that, we think God is not a merciful God. We think God is not a forgiving God. We think God is someone like the enemy, you know, just attack us for no reason. He has a reason for everything that happens in our lives. And we've got to hold on to that, my friends. We have got to say, I'm not sure why this has happened. And I believe, as Charles said, that, and I was trying to read something about John MacArthur, it's okay, because when we think it, God knows we're thinking, what brought this to mind? Why is this going on? Why is this happening? He understands our human mind, our human thoughts. He knows exactly what we're thinking. And He has done beautiful things for people. Some it's waiting. Some it's time. Some it's maybe unanswered prayer, you know. I mean, young ladies and their desire to get married, they're like, where is He? I said, I don't know. But you have to ask God yourself, and maybe there is always a reason. But hold on to the fact that when something happens to us, unless, you know, there are things we do that are, you know, consequential things. You know, you killed somebody, you shot somebody, things like that. But you have got to understand, even then, God is a forgiving God. God is a merciful God. I don't know why some people are well. I don't know why some people are sick. I don't know why some people died of COVID. I don't know why your parents aren't living or your parents are deceased. We don't know why people are in pain. We don't know why people aren't healed. But God certainly knows, and He sees the beauty as people go through whatever they're going through and crying out to Him and calling out to Him and getting closer to Him and not saying, I fell down because I did something bad. If we look that way, it's very dangerous. We've got to say, God, You know exactly what's going to happen today, and we just pray for safety as we drive. We pray for mercy as we go about our day. We just don't know everything there is about God, but we can ask Him. God has the ability to heal, to not heal, to extend life, to not extend life. We see it all through the scriptures, how He did, how He brought people in place, whether they were judges, whether they were apostles, disciples, how God just worked, bringing the Lord Jesus Christ. We can have a first-eye glimpse of someone who is holy. What does He look like? How does He act? We get to see that. So hold on to the fact that when things happen, they happen to me just as well. Came out, locked my keys in the car. Why did that happen? But the beauty of it is how the Lord worked it out. I don't know everything, but I do know that I can say, God, thank You for
providing help. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for getting me to work safely. Thank you for preventing me from that guy running into me. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And so many other things. So we have to hold on to that we're not being punished, we're not being beaten, we're not being spanked. Now, yes, there's sin that God will discipline us about, and we have to make sure that we confess it and deal with that and say, Father, you know, yeah, that was wrong, or how I spoke to that lady was unkind, or how I reacted about that, it wasn't wise. And that's the beauty, because we get to see that sin for ourselves. We get to say, you know what, Lord, you were right. How I handled that was not quite right. I could have done it this way. And sometimes, many times, he gives us another opportunity to do it right. So I just wanted to point that.
Amen.
Okay, now, we have to close out. And one thing, we are not, us believers, we are not Satan. And the reason I'm saying that, First Peter says that.
What did you say? We are not what?
Only unredeemable person.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Satan. Everyone can be redeemed.
Yes.
That's why I said we're not Satan. But anyway, we're going to close out. And if I could, Sister Smith, could I get you, Beverly, could I get you to close us out?
Sure.
In prayer?
Okay. Father in heaven, we thank you for your love, this love that we long for, that we desire, that we need. We thank you that you watch over us during the day, during the night. Thank you, Father, that we're not like you. Father, that you are a God of holiness. You are a righteous God. Father, your hand is not too short to pull us out. You say you hold the world in the palm of your hand. Everything that's going on, even with the bugs and spiders and all kind of critters I'm afraid of, you still hold them in the palm of your hand. You hold us in the palm of your hand. You still have control over everything. And we thank you that even though whatever is going on and all the things that are going on in our world today, you are still in control. And we thank you for that. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ who saved us. We thank you and believe that we know you're coming back again. Father, thank you for just being merciful for us, just being loving to us when we're unlovable. Thank you, Father. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, y'all got 2 minutes to get prepared for the
Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.